Greetings all, Kaiwaza with you. Welcome back to my channel. And on a somewhat cloudy Tuesday, as I'm recording this, it's time for another edition of The Cheap Lounge. What is The Cheap Lounge? It's a series I've been doing. I have an online easy listening radio station called Moody Mood Music. That's linked below. You can listen anytime. It's just a hobby station amongst two other stations I have of kind of old school easy listening elevator music, lounge music, whatever you want to call it. And I upload stuff every week. And in Cheap Lounge, we're going to discuss some of the records that I uploaded this week. And they're all, for the most part, from dollar bin records and thrift stores. So we're talking really cheap recordings here. Not, you know, high cost, fancy schmancy ones. So let's look at these, a couple of the records from this week. First up I do apologize, this record cover is kind of beaten up, for real, but this is Carmen, McRae. The album is called When We're Young. This record is from 1959. Oddly, many records this week are from 1959, as fate would have it. I do love this cover. She's, you know, in a sort of moody look, very sort of somber. We have the painted railroad tracks here, and I love the mood that this creates. And indeed, from the liner notes, it does say, here's the music of the, I love these notes, by the way. Here is the music of the long, lonely hours of the night. The empty feeling of a deserted railway station, silent tracks glistening mutely beneath soft crying rain, and the misty wilderness of solitude, characterized by the unforgettable voice of Carmen McRae. I do like Carmen McRae. A little bit about her. She's considered one of the most influential jazz singers of the 20th century. And her inspiration was actually Billie Holiday. And she would often on her albums try to do at least one song that was associated with Billie Holiday. She was born in Harlem, New York, 1920. And her parents were both immigrants from Jamaica. And she was really known as a singer. Not as a singer first. She started out playing piano, and she was a piano player in different, you know, supper clubs and different venues in New York. She went to Chicago for a while, and there she really picked up on her piano playing, and she started singing as well. This was in the 40s. She went back to New York in the early 50s, and there she signed with Decca, who she did like 12 albums with, and that's when her career, you know, nationwide, like really took off. So she recorded so many albums over the years. This one, not with Decca, this is with Cap, but she did so many records and became so well known that way. And she's really known for having a very clear voice and very good enunciation. I would agree with that. I mean, definitely, it's very clear. You can totally understand the lyrics, very well enunciated. She performed, after her recording career, she continued to perform in like jazz clubs and jazz festivals and different supper clubs and engagements and specials through the 1980s. And then at the beginning of the 90s, 91, I think it was, she'd had a stroke after a performance, and she, by her own choice at that point, just stopped performing, right? And she lived until 1994, and she actually had a stroke a little earlier in 94 and convalesced, whatever, and was at home. It was back at home, but actually fell into a semi-coma at home and passed away in 94. But yeah, she left quite a large number of recordings, and this is one that we're happy to play. out. Oh, and I do want to point out, I never point out the inner sleeves. Often these little inner sleeves are fascinating, but of course with dollar bin records and thrift stores and stuff, a lot of times either there is no inner sleeve or it's not the original inner sleeve that came with the album. But in this one, it appears to be. But I just want to show you this from Cap because it has some cute, cute kind of clip art on it.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. There is no sunrise when your lover has gone. What lonely hours the evening shadows bring.
Up next, we have an instrumental recording. This is on RCA Victor. It is also from 1959. It's not like I went through and picked out records this week from 1959. It just happened that way. Dennis Farnon and his orchestra. This is called The Enchanted Woods. Now, instrumental album, what you'll notice, this is sort of a conceptual album, I guess. Although, I don't know. I don't really know whether the conception and the instrumentation really go together to me. But I'll read a little bit from the liner notes here. The combined magic of Alice's Looking Glass, The Wizard of Oz, and Cinderella's Fairy Godmother could hardly conjure up a more romantic, colorful, and warmly delightful realm of fantasy than Dennis Farnon's The Enchanted Woods. The path through this magical forest is a rainbow of dazzling musical color, constantly changing and moved from delicate pastels to tones of deep, rich intensity. So the deal, though, with this record is not just a normal orchestra. It's only for this album, he only used woodwind, the woodwinds. There's no strings, there's no brass, only woodwinds. Now, you might be familiar with maybe Jackie Gleason, who did a whole series of very, very easy listening albums and would usually have some sort of different shtick in each one. One of them, I think it was called Night Winds, that I have on the station playing now, featured a wood flutes, woodwinds primarily, but there is, you know, a regular orchestra. This one, there is no regular orchestra. It's 100%, it's all woodwinds. Collection of alto, a collection of saxophones, a collection of clarinets, flutes with piccolos, oboes, English horns, bassoons, and contrabassoons. That to me does not induce a fairy tale like sound, if that's what you're conceptually trying to do. I would think like strings would actually do that. It's sort of the opposite, and like celestes or something, you know, but little harpsichord maybe, bells. Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting. You can listen for yourself, see what you think. I don't know. Dennis Farnon, by the way, was originally a Canadian orchestra leader, and he actually did move to England in the 60s, and I think might, I don't know if he's best known, but I think what's interesting about that time in the 60s that he spent in England is that's when he discovered production music and library music, which was music that would be used, recorded and used specifically for television stations and radio stations and filmmakers and whatever to use this music however they wanted to, automatically with permission to use it that way. And that was a big business. There are plenty of production libraries. He kind of discovered it then, signed up with several different publishing firms, and he wrote and composed and published tons and tons and tons of production library music in the 60s in England. And if you look him up on Discogs, you can see how much, tons of it. Anyway, that's Dennis Farnon.
I'm on a date with a daydream. Wouldn't you like to go on a date with a daydream too? You can, you know. All you have to do is tune in to Moody Mood Music on live365.com. Moody Mood Music is the radio station that plays all the beautiful, relaxing, easy-listening favorites of years gone by that will take you away on a fluffy cloud of musical enchantment. It's like a date with a daydream. Let's go on one, shall we? Join me at Moody Mood Music on live365.com. The link is in the description below.
Here's a record that's kind of a personal story really with me, but this is Miss Jane Froman, the album and the movie that this is a soundtrack from is called With a Song in My Heart. Now, I love this picture. My mother had the 10-inch version of this when I was a little kid, and I used to play it a lot. And the reason I played it a lot was that the opening number, to me, is very grandiose and da-da-da-da-da, whatever. And it just, as a kid, I loved, you know, pageants, and I loved Miss USA and Miss Universe, and I would get all excited about it. And I would play this record before those shows if they were coming up like later in the week. And it would get me really excited because it sounds like the opening of a huge pageant, you know, and here she is in her evening gown. And I'll play that little part right here because it would just get me in the mood for, you know, this Miss Universe pageant. This actually, and interestingly enough, I was happy to find this in a dollar bin because I've never seen it, I don't think, since my mother had it. And this is a 12-inch, so it came out a little bit later. The original came out in 1952. This says it's an abridged reissue. Doesn't give the date, and there's no date for it on Discogs. But as far as I can tell, I mean, I have checked it out and everything. It's not abridged at all. I don't know why they say it's abridged. It's the same songs, exactly the same content that was in the 10-inch LP and in the collection of 78 shellacs. So it's not a bridge from what I can tell, but they say it is. Anyway, I didn't know anything about her. Like, I guess my mother had that record all these years and I never really paid any attention to the back of it to see what it said. This is actually Jane Froman. This is really Susan Hayward, who was in the film, but anyway, played her in the film. Jane Froman was an actress. I didn't know. I mean, I just learned this with this record. Was an actress and a singer in the 40s, quite popular. She was originally from Universal City, Missouri, and she was also a member of the Ziegfeld Follies. So she was quite a lovely thing, you know. was in a USO plane, you know, on a USO tour or whatever, when that plane crashed in, and it was in Portugal. And there were, you know, several deaths. She did survive, but she survived with some permanent, like, injuries that plagued her the rest of her life. They almost had to amputate one of her legs, but they ended up not doing that. She had multiple, she had a compound fracture in her leg. She had multiple fractures in her arm. Yeah, and they plagued her all of her life, and there were times after this where she went out performing and what everything for decades, but like had to use a cane or had to be braced up or whatever at certain times to be able to appear. And she had traded seats with someone, had requested her to trade seats. It was another singer named Tamara Drazen, had requested to change seats with her on the plane, which she did, and Tamara was killed in the crash. And her biographer that wrote Jane Froman's biographer said that that was something that plagued her, Jane Froman, all her life, that it followed her all her life. She always just had, you know, a very, felt some guilt or responsibility or, you know, really badly about trading seats with Tamara Drazen. Anyway, they made a movie about her. It's called With the Song of My Heart. Susan Hayward played Jane Froman, although all of the songs on the soundtrack are actually sung by Jane Froman. It was just Susan Hayward as the actress portraying her.
I walk alone because, to tell you the truth, I belong. How happy we will be.
Alright, up next, an album that, I don't really have a whole lot to say about. I pulled this one out thinking this is going to be so cool and really fun and exciting. Hugo Montenegro and his orchestra, well-known orchestra leader, Hugo in Wonderland. These are all interprets. Hugo Montenegro interprets the genius of Stevie Wonder. And I think, okay, this is going to be super groovy and great and really cool. And I was really disappointed. I gotta tell you, I'm disappointed, honestly. It's really primarily electronic. There's a lot of electronic instrumentation on this. And not so much of an actual orchestra, you know, covering like Stevie Wonder songs, but it's very funky. And in fact, to me, this actually is like too funky. Like, there are several songs on here. Superstition, for example, we all know that song, I think. Superstition, da, 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 da. Like, you can't, there are several songs to me when I was playing this and digitizing this that I'm like, where's the song? Like, I don't even hear the tune of the song. I just hear a bunch of riffs and a bunch of funky stuff going on. And like, where's Superstition? Where's the song? And you know, for easy listening music, yeah, you can do all kinds of crazy stuff with the arrangement, but the song, the tune is very fundamental to easy listening music. And if you obscure the tune, it's sort of like the melody. It's like, what is this? You know, like, I don't know. Anyway, there were a couple tracks I liked, but overall, I'm gonna say this album for me was a disappointment. Yeah, 1974 is what it's when it's from. Sorry. Wow! Finally today, we have another male vocalist. This is on RCA Dynagroove. It's from 1966. Glenn Yarbrough, The Lonely Things. So we have, you know, Carmen McRae being sad because her lover has gone away and when you're alone. And now we have Glenn Yarbrough, who's lonely, lonely. Maybe they should meet, you know? I don't know. Anyway, this record, yeah, I've been hanging on to this for a while. I've seen this one quite a bit in some dollar bins, but I never picked it up, but I did now. The reason I picked it up is because the subtitle here is The Love Songs of Rod McEwen. Now, I love Rod McEwen. I don't know if you know Rod McEwen. He did a lot of albums in the 60s, in the 70s. A poet, kind of a beatnik poet, sort of, I guess, who recorded a lot of albums, many albums of his poetry, and he wrote music also. So sometimes he's singing, and sometimes he's just reading his poetry with music. And the poetry is kind of like, I don't know, you know, some people think it's really drivel, some people enjoy. I like the sort of sentimentality and sort of sadness. I like sort of melancholic poetry, I don't know. And he's good with that, even though sometimes it doesn't make sense. You're like, what are you even really talking about? I don't know. This is Rod McEwen, by the way, one of his many albums. I have yet to digitize this one. This is a double LP. I mean, just two records of Rod McEwen, probably more than most people can take. Anyway, Glenn Yarbrough, I don't know why he did an album of Rod McEwen stuff. I mean, I don't know if they have a friendship or if there's some reason that happened. It doesn't really explain it. But Glenn Yarbrough was a folk singer. Okay, so he has passed away. He passed away in 2016. Was a folk singer originally with the lead singer of the Limelighters, and that was kind of a pretty well-known group. He was singing, doing some singing, originally from Milwaukee, Wisconsin. He went into the Korean War. When he came back from the Korean War, he was in, I think it's Denver, and he opened up a nightclub called the Limelight, and eventually decided to form a singing group, including himself, called the Limelighters. The Limelighters had huge success. They recorded like 10 albums and or something like that, and did really well. Then after that success, he decided he was kind of done with performing and he wanted to teach music, right? So he sold a lot of stuff that he had because he had acquired, you know, a good bit of money there with the Limelighters and his nightclub and stuff. And he sold many things and he opened up a music school in LA for primarily underprivileged kids. And it ran out of money because I guess he didn't really know how to run a business and was not good with the money, and the money kind of ran out and it closed, but he did have good intentions.
And when they finally find a lover, they betray him with another. And at 20, yet another, the women. And all the time we follow them to see if they'll remain our enemy, these painted signs from the sea. At 20, they're tearing down the building across the street. And the old woman who sat cushion high behind the flower boxes is gone. Even the children who played hopscotch along the broken sidewalk have disappeared. Only the multicolored cat preening in the shop window is unconcerned.
Okay. I don't like his voice that much. I don't know if you like Glenn Yarbrough. I find his, to me, I'm not a folk singing fan. I'm not crazy about folk singers. And I find his voice to be kind of thin and very, warbly. A lot of vibrato there. I do really, really like his spoken parts on this record, because some of these selections are Rod McEwen poems, not songs, and he's reading the poem, and I really like his reading voice. I really enjoy it. Not as much as Rod McEwen's, because Rod McEwen's is kind of rough and gravelly, and I really like it. Very different from Rod McEwen's, but I do like his reading of the Rod McEwen poems on here, such as I think Night Song and Brownstone, and yeah. I like the song The Women a lot. Kind of a sexist song, but I mean, it was 1970, 60, it was 1966, I mean, you know. Anyway, yeah, Glenn Yarbrough. I don't know. I'd be curious to hear y'all's opinions in the comment section below, because I know some of this music this week I'm kind of dogging on. like not really impressed, okay, some of it. But, I mean, there are selections that I like, and of course I did upload and some music selections from all these albums that are on Moody Mood Music that you can listen to anytime, 24 hours, 7 days a week. That link is below, so check that out if you are interested. And leave comments below about any of these artists or their music. Yeah, I think that's it. So have a good week, you guys, and we will talk to you later.